Hey guys, welcome back to my channel. I'm Dr. Pavitra, and before we start our discussion for today, there are a few things that I would like to ask or discuss with you guys. Number one, would you like me to continue these kind of, you know, writing notes kind of presentations, or would you like a PowerPoint presentation? My idea was smaller things, smaller topics, difficult topics. I can maybe put it down in notes like this for, you know, quick reference before your exams, and detailed explanations or pathophysiologies and, you know, detailed discussions can be done over PowerPoint. I would like to know your point of views also. That is number one. Number two, please don't ask me to buy a tablet right now. I'm not planning to spend that much money on a tablet, and when I do, you will definitely see in my classes, right? Okay, but that is not right now in the cards for me. Point three, so in these notes, 10 minute takes or 15 minute takes kind of presentations, I am planning to discuss something else apart from vaccines today. Let me know if this is also working for you, because I'm not sure if I'll be able to complete it within the 10 minute time period. I would definitely try to, but I just want to know if you would like for me to discuss topics other than vaccines in these kind of notes. Okay. So today I thought we will start with surfactant, right? I really, really don't know why this will not, you know, correctly focus, especially when I've written something already. All right. So when a question like this is asked, okay, so what you would start with is, you will start with a definition or an intro, something about physiology, if you know, okay, then you will talk about the indications for use, okay, and especially for surfactant discussion, I am going to talk about its use in respiratory distress syndrome, how to use, when to use, how much to use, etc. Okay, right, so let's get into the topic proper. So as far as definition or introduction is concerned, it is easy enough. Surfactant is a substance that decreases surface tension, right? So surfactant is naturally produced in our body. You don't have to do anything about it. What about the physiology? How is it produced? Where it is produced? Right? So physiology wise, all of us know things about surfactant, but, you know, putting it together during a theory exam is sort of difficult. So if we have an outline of what we should write, I think it will be easier, and that is what I'm trying to do. So physiology, where is it produced? It's produced in type 2 pneumocytes in lungs. Correct. What does it contain? It contains about the main content is dipalmitoyl phosphatidylcholine, and 50% is saturated and 20% is unsaturated. The second content is phosphatidylglycerol around 16%. Then apoprotein is around 6%. Then cholesterol is around 8%. So these are the contents of a surfactant. What is the action of a surfactant? Action is again the definition. It reduces the surface tension. Make sure the alveoli are open. Right. Okay. So what are the indications for use? Where are the indications that you definitely use or you may use a surfactant for? So surfactant, one, you definitely know it is being used for respiratory distress syndrome in preterms. Next, it can be used in selected situations in mass. Like in X-ray, you are definitely seeing a complete whiteout picture. Or you definitely know the surfactant has leached out and it's looking like that. Then you may consider using it. Then similar situation as in a neonatal pneumonia, it can be considered whenever there is an oxygenation index of more than 15, or if there is a pulmonary hemorrhage and the child is deteriorating, you may give this a trial. So these are some of the indications that you may consider. Next, we will discuss mainly about how to use in respiratory distress syndrome. Okay. Respiratory distress syndrome, preterm condition, surfactant deficiency, all those stories you will have to write. Okay, I will not be talking about those here. Okay. So which preterms will you give? You will give preterms, all preterms, okay, more than 28 weeks, Now I think this can even get reduced because even more than 26 weekers are surviving well in most of the neonatal units, correct? So more than 28 weekers plus a strong suspicion of RDS. What is a strong suspicion? You see the baby who's struggling to breathe. You know this baby is not going to have surfactants. Is there something that you can, you know, objectively assess and do? So when do you give it? So when the FiO2 requirement is more than 30 to 40% after recruitment with CPAP. Okay, so as soon as a preterm baby is born, the delivery room CPAP is being practiced more and more nowadays. So you have recruited the lung well, but despite that, this baby is requiring more and more oxygen. And the child is not able to maintain a saturation of more than 90%. Or the child is becoming apneic multiple times. Then yes, this child might require a surfactant. So what are the types of, or depending upon what time you give, it varies. One is delivery room CPAP. Okay, I mean delivery room surfactant. Prophylactically you give. Efficacy still query. Okay. Next is early rescue. Early rescue is within 2 hours. This is what is mostly being practiced. Late rescue is more than, or say after 12 to 24 hours of birth. That is late rescue. Okay, preferably give it in early rescue part. How to give? How to give? You can do invasive, mildly invasive, or almost non-invasive. You can put it that way. Invasive is your Ensure technique. What is Ensure? Intubate, surfactant, and extubate. You intubate, put a ET tube, put a nasogastric tube through it, give surfactant, then get it out, ventilate the baby. Okay? Ventilate through CPAP, not invasive ventilation. Okay? The invasive part is you are actually putting the laryngoscope. Mildly invasive is you use a laryngoscope, but you don't put in a ET tube. You just use a nasogastric tube or whatever tube is being followed. And you administer surfactant. Non-invasive is without a laryngoscope, just the tube alone goes inside and you give surfactant. Clear? This one is mildly invasive surfactant therapy, MIST. Non-invasive is LISA, less invasive surfactant therapy. You are just putting in the tube. Okay? This LISA and MIST have a very high chance of being asked, and I think I will cover it in the next session. If you guys approve, that is. Okay, so now you know how you are going to give, correct? How much to give? That is the next question. How much depends on, focus. How much to give depends on what sort of the surfactant you are using. Okay, so there are three: Survanta, Infasurf, Curosurf. Focus, camera, focus, please. Thank you. So there are three types. Okay, the why is it not focusing? Yeah, better now. Correct. So there are three types. These are all naturally derived. Okay, one more. There is a synthetic surfactant which is called as lucinactant. This is not produced anymore because naturally occurring surfactants are definitely better. Okay, Survanta is from bovine lung extract. Infasurf is calf lung lavage fluid. Curosurf is porcine pig lung extract. Okay, so these two are extracts, this is a lavage. All right, so Survanta is Beractant, Infasurf is Calfactant, porcine is correct Poractant. Okay, first few letters are being used. And active component. These will be the active components. So how much to give? See, the dose varies from 100 mg to 200 mg per kg of the phospholipid component. Okay, phospholipid is the main content, isn't it? So that is what we saw in our constituents of surfactant. So for Survanta or Beractant, this has approximately 25 mg per ml of phospholipid. So the dose will be 4 ml per kg. Infasurf has 35 mg per ml of phospholipid and the dose will be 3 ml per kg because the concentration is more. Understood? Curosurf has 76 mg per ml of phospholipid and the dose will be very much less, 2.5 ml per kg. All right? Okay. So this is how much you will give. What about repeat doses? Should we give repeat doses? It can be considered whenever there is persistent requirement of oxygen, more than 30% FiO2 requirement. Okay, then you can give. When to give the repeat dose? At least 6 hours. You can give it as early as even 2 hours. Okay, but ideally wait for at least 6 hours. This is a grade A recommendation. Okay, and don't give more than 3 doses. It is not going to have any effect. Okay, so surfactant, this is how you are going to give. After giving, what do you expect? You expect the compliance of the lung to improve. Okay, so if the compliance or the amount the lung can expand improves, the pressure requirement comes down. This is very important for actually managing the babies, because if you don't reduce the pressures for the lung which is actually improving, what will happen? The lung which will slowly improve, and the pressure requires come down, and you continue giving this higher pressure, it is going to burst at some point in time, right? You will create air leaks unnecessarily. So don't do that. So make sure you give adequate pressure and reduce the pressure as the child improves. Okay, suppose you are not doing that, what will happen? One of the adverse reactions is air leaks. What are the other adverse drug reactions that you can expect? When you are giving a surfactant, you can expect some amount of hypoxemia, bradycardia. There can be a ET tube block. There can be pulmonary hemorrhage. Okay, but it is not associated with much increased mortality compared to other causes of pulmonary hemorrhage. And air leaks, over distension and air leaks, if you are not adjusting the pressure appropriately. Okay, so importance is to rapidly wean the child to CPAP or give proper pressure support mode of ventilation. Okay, so I think this is enough for us to write in a 5 marks or a 10 marks question, isn't it so? So rest of the things in detailed discussion, I think I will do it in a PowerPoint at a later date. Thank you guys. Please subscribe, share among your academic groups so we can all learn this together. If anything can be improved apart from me buying a laptop, let me know and I will definitely do that. Bye-bye. Take care.